Today we're going to talk about the Wyliodrin dashboard. You've been using it for some days, but I want to summarize what it can do and how it can help you in building your projects. So the outline for today is talking about the dashboard, talking about how to send signals and how to process them. So what are the tools for signal processing? You discussed about filters and systems, and tomorrow you're going to use them. So I wanted to give you the tools for it. So first of all, this is the Wyliodrin dashboard. It's kind of drag and drop. So you can drag and drop widgets and display information onto them. It's for debugging purposes. It's not intended for industrial use or for building real applications. It's only for debugging and visualizing your system. Okay, so it has buttons. It has several widgets, widgets that can control your device and widgets that can display data. First of all, we're going to talk about buttons and sliders, and we've used some of them. So basically, the first widget, control widget that we have is the button, the two-state button. It's basically an on-off switch. Its properties are the signal that it needs to send out. The signal needs to be lowercase and without any spaces. And it can be also a push button. But if you do not check this, the switch is going to look like this. It has a color, so you can set the color of the switch. It's going to show on the on state. How does it work? The moment you press it, it sends the value 1 if it's on. If you press it again, it sends 0 when it's on 0. So basically, it sends the state to your program. Inside the program, you are using the receive signal node. And in visual programming, I think it's on receive signal. It's a block with on receive signal. And that's how you get the signal from the button. The push button, it's the same widget, just that it has the push checked. It's a button, it's a colored button, and it works exactly like a push button. So when you press it, it's going to send a 1, it's going to wait a little amount of time, and then it's going to send 0 once again. It doesn't work if you keep pressing it. So if you just click the mouse and keep it clicked, it's not going to work. So when you press it, it's going to send a 1, wait, and then send a 0. If you need a button that needs to have a constant value of 1, then you need to use a switch. So some of you had this error. Basically, this button is going to send two signals, two values, actually. 1, wait, and then a 0. So when you need to do something, when the button is switched or pressed, you need to check if the signal is 1. Okay, the slider. This is the slider that you used yesterday for measuring the distance. Once again, it has the signal, it has a color, and it has a minimum and a maximum value, plus the step. You can drag and drop the slider. You can drag the slider. Each time it changes the value, it's going to send a signal to your program saying, this is my new value. If for some reason the program wants to change the slider itself, it can send back a signal, and the slider is going to change. So if you have a send signal with the name numeric, in this example, if you have send signal numeric and send the value, you will see the slider moving. This is valid also for buttons. So the moment you send back to the dashboard the signal with the name of the button, you will see it switches. Okay. Also on the buttons and on the sliders, you can have more sliders. So as you see, you have a small plus sign over here. If you click the plus, you can add more sliders and more buttons with the same properties. It was an example with an RGB LED. So basically, there we had three sliders, red, green, and blue, from 0 to 255, all had the same properties. By default, the slider has the value 5 when it starts. So graphs. These are important, and it's important to know how to use them. The main idea is to replace the print function with the graphs. So instead of printing values on the display, the console, please use the graphs. It's much better to visualize a value. When you print a value and there's a lot of values, and for instance, you have a sampling rate of 10 samples a second, there's no way you can see it. So please keep in mind and try to print it on a graph. We have lines, several types of lines, bars, a speedometer, a gauge, several other interesting gadgets. I'm not going to present every gadget. I'm going to talk about lines and bars, and then we're going to see how to use them. More or less, the graphs are the same. So basically, for the line graph is the most complex graph that we have. Basically, you can display more than one signal on the same graph. So just by hitting the plus, you can add more signals, and they are going to be displayed on the same image. Signals have a color, so you can choose a color for each of them. The graph has a name. It can display the legend, or you can hide the legend. By default, the line graph is going to have a relative axis. So actually floating axis. So based on the points, on the extreme points that you have, it's going to build the y-axis. So for instance, at the beginning, it's going to be between 0 and 1. If you send the point with 10, it's going to be between 0 and 10. If you send the minus 3, it's between minus 3 and 10, and so on and so forth. If you send values from 5 to 10, it will switch from 5 to 10. So please be careful. This can be misleading. So if you really want to see the value on a full scale, hit the fixed axis. For logarithmic sensors, you can use the logarithmic axis, so it will actually display the logarithm of the value that you send. It can be a time series, or it can be a point series. What's the difference? So the time series has on the x-axis the timestamp. So a time series is a signal that has one value at a time. And when you send the signal, your program will automatically add the timestamp to it. So basically, you send the value. The system will send us the value and the timestamp. So each time you make send signal, we receive the timestamp and the value on the graph. This is how we plot this. If you do not need a timestamp, or for instance, you want to plot a vector or an array, you have to uncheck this. So in that moment, you're not going to have dates here. You're going to have positions in the array, or you're going to have some other x-axis that you define. So basically, keep in mind that the line can be either a time series, either a normal array graph. Just to give you an example, we talked about time signals with Andrei yesterday. So if we have the signal from a temperature sensor, it varies in time. But if we compute the Fourier transformation, this axis is not the time anymore, it's frequencies. So if you need to display the Fourier transformation, you don't have to check time series. Is it clear? OK. It has a minimum and a maximum value. It also has a value property called show points. And it will point out the points where it actually received data. Because the line, as you can see it here, received points here, 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 here. So only at the points where it's not completely straight. So the line was basically computed based on the points that it received. If you need to see exactly the point, you can have show points. Also, there's another value which will ask you how many point signals to display. By default, this is 10. So it's going to display 10 points, and then it's going to shift the graph. If you need to see more, you have to increase this value. If you want to see an infinite number of points, so it will never shift, just put 0. So the value can be 0. Any questions? The step line, this is how it looks like. A step line is good for digital signals, usually signals that are 1 and 0. Instead of drawing, so as you can see, these are the points that it received, so the points where the signal bends. If this would be a line, it would be like really strange. But if it's a signal that has a fixed amount of fixed value for an amount of time, this is the best representation. Can you give me an example of where can you use something like this? What? Give an example of a digital signal. A clock, so to sample a clock, something.
The clock produces, I don't know, just a
the clock is in steps. Basically, the clock gets 0 and 1. If you draw lines, it will be triangles, indeed. So if you use this kind of graph, it will be triangles. You're right, because it's 1 and 0. That's the point, to use a step line. So basically, this will draw horizontal lines, and it's going to draw a vertical line the moment the signal changes. So basically, this is the step line. Another example is the button that you used. When you use a button, you can check if the button is pressed, or you sample the button as pressed by displaying the value that is sampled on a step line. And then you can see if it goes up or down. Same properties as the other signal. It can be logarithmic, it can be a time series, it can be an array series. So if you want to see the array, you can simply put this. Usually this is for discrete values. So what you have to understand from a signal like this, usually the period where the signal is horizontal is a period where we don't know the value of the signal, we suppose it is like that. So we sample it, and for a period of time, we think that this is the value of the signal. So this step line really represents the signal that we sampled. The normal line does not. The normal line assumes the signal goes like this. So between two points, the normal line assumes the signal is a straight line. This one assumes the signal is sampled, so we don't know the value. It assumes the value stays fixed. Any questions? The spline line. The spline line is a normal line, but the interpolation is not a straight line between points, but it's a Bezier curve. So if at this line it's very clear which were the points, can you imagine which were the points? At the spline line, it's not very clear where it's sampled. So it tries to give you an idea of how the signal looks or might look by drawing Bezier curves around a Bezier curve around the points that you sampled. So it's somehow a fitted curve. Here, the show points option is a really good idea because it's going to mark you on the graph which is the point that it sampled. So this one can be misleading. If the signal varies very fast, it's very misleading. Again, can be time series, can be a vector series. Depends on your choice. Any questions? Another thingy can be the... the slide is really wrong. It's not pins, it's points. Engineers love beer. So basically, the points marker is going to display you only the points. So in fact, it's going to show you the real signal. So when you sample a signal or send back a signal, this is basically what you know. This is a fake one, so it's an interpolation. This is what you think you know, what you think the signal was. But in reality, this is the signal that you have. Puts things in perspective, no? Okay, same thing. Obviously, this has no show points option because it shows the points. It can be logarithmic, it can be time series, or it can be vector series. Please remember, this is exactly what you know. In most cases, this is just for fun. I'm not seeing exactly the application of this. My suggestion would be to use a spline line each time and plot the points on the spline lines, and then you know exactly what you have, what kind of graph you have. All the lines have a little menu over here, the three lines that you can see. Those display a menu where you can save the graph as a picture, or you can export the values from the graph. Values are good for inserting in some mathematical language. Any questions to lines? Okay, the bar graph. So the bar graph is a widget which displays one value of a signal. So this bar is going to go up and down depending on the last value that it receives. So the bar graph displays more than one signals. It can display more than one signals. For each signal that it has, it displays the last value. Options are very simple. Fixed axis again, if you want a fixed axis or not. Minimum and maximum values. And you have also a real-time update. What's the real-time update? Exactly. So due to browser laziness and browser overhead, if we would draw the graphs the moment we receive the signals, you would not be able to work on your computer. Please remember JavaScript works in a virtual machine, which is sometimes not very fast. So the amount of signals that you send is high, so you won't be able to work. So what we do, line signals are updated 3 times a second. So is the bar. For a line signal, it doesn't matter. Why? For the line, you will see the points anyway. It doesn't matter if you see it 3 times a second or 30 times a second. It doesn't lose points. So if you have sent 10 points, it will display the next 10 points in 0.3 seconds. But for this graph, it will not display the points that it received before. So it will display the last point that it received, but 3 times a second. So if you send faster than this, you will lose some of the points. I don't see how you can see them, but if for some reason you need this, you have to know that any graph that has an instant value, so displays only the last value, has this option. Please be careful on using it, you might block your browser. So, any questions here? Okay. We also have a thermometer, a gauge, a voometer. I think they are very self-explanatory. They work exactly like the bar. So same options, they display the last value. The custom widget is the really interesting one. Well, sometimes you want to build your own widget and we don't provide it. So the custom widget functions exactly like the bar. It displays one signal and only the last value of the signal. How does it do this? If you see this slide, do you have any idea?
Yeah. So the picture corresponding to the value you set it to.
It displays a picture depending on the value of the signal. So it gets signals that start with zero. For zero, it will display the first picture in this edit box. So on each line in this edit box, on the edit box, you have a link. So when you send the signal, it will display the first picture. When you send the signal with one, it will display the second picture. So on and so forth. For number two, it will display the third picture. So this is how you can do this. The only constraint is the link needs to be HTTPS, otherwise browsers will block it. Simplest way to do it is to use Dropbox or some other file storage system. Put a picture on your Dropbox, right click on it, share link, and paste the link over here. Only small change that you need to do is this DL in front of Dropbox, www.dropbox.com, and your link is going to take you to the Dropbox page. The DL is going to download the file. So you need to switch www with DL. That's the custom widget. So you can display whatever you want. The best example that I can come up with is to put a light sensor and display if the light is on or off. So you put a step, and if the light sensor has a value larger than the step, you send the value 0 or 1. Otherwise, you send the value 0. Here you put two pictures, one with a light bulb which is lit, the other one with a simple light bulb. System simply changes them. Any questions? Try it. What's the QR code? You've seen during these days that when you start your program, you have a QR code. What does this do? Basically, you scan the code, and you can open the dashboard on your mobile device. Any mobile device, so for Wyliodrin.com, it works on any device. For the private deployment that we have for the Politecnica, Some devices don't recognize the certificate, so that might be tricky. Basically, for Wyliodrin.com, it works. If you have a newer device, it works again. So this is the code. Scanning it displays the graphs, the whole dashboard on your phone. Not only does it display it, but you can interact with the buttons and the sliders in that dashboard. So if you want to make a remote control for your device, put the buttons on the dashboard and you can remote control them from the device. You should try this as well. Also, the console is also visible, but the console is not writable. So you cannot write text in the console, but you can see all the errors and all the messages and all the logs. Should work on any HTML5. Any questions? Okay, here we go. So, sending signals. We discussed about the dashboard. Now let's see how we can send the signals to the dashboard. From the streams programming, we have a node called sendSignal, and some dot here is the name of the signal that I want to send. It will send by default time series, so each time you put a value into it, it will attach the timestamp and send it to the cloud. It can send signal points, and it can send arrays. So this is how the payload looks like for this node. The payload needs to be either a number, either an array. If it's a number, it will check if it has the X component. So if the message has the X component, it will decide it's a point, it's not a time series, and it will send the point X and the number here. You need to have a graph that is able to display a line or any line which is not a time series. You also have a flag component for time series only. If this flag is present on the graph, it will put a small flag with the text that you have on the flag message. This is really useful for debugging, for instance, with something, okay, I got through here. Or if you want to send an SMS or want to send a message somehow, you can put, okay, send signal for whatever value you have, and the flag, I have sent the message. So this is particularly useful for debugging. It works only for time series. So if the payload is an array, it will directly send XY points, so IJ points. For each element in the array, it will consider X as being the position in the array. Is this clear? So if you have an array with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 9, it will send 1 with position 0, 2 with position 1, so on and so forth. Is it clear? Particularly useful for FFT. So what's this set X for some dot horizontal? As I said, if you have a number and you want to send a signal which is not a time series, you need an X component. So instead of writing a function, you can use this block. So you have a block, send out the value that you want to send, put the value inside this block. This block is going to set the value of X in the message to the variable sum.horizontal in my example. This is a value from the global context. So if you have a variable context.global.something, this block is going to set the X to that variable. So it's like set value, but instead of setting the value, it gets the value and puts it on the X. Is it clear? Okay. We have another node, which is called Octave. This is not for signal sending, but it's for signal processing. Basically, this is a function, but you can write Octave code inside of it. You receive the message over here. In Octave, this will be the message. So the variable MSG, and precisely MSG, is the message that you receive. Here I'm computing the fast Fourier transform, and actually the absolute value of the fast Fourier transform. because FFT is complex. So basically, I'm replacing the payload with the absolute value of the FFT of the payload's transformation. What kind of data is payload here? It's what? No, payload is an array. Payload is an array. Most probably, it's an array of real numbers because you don't have complex numbers in JavaScript. But FFT of message.payload will be complex. So it's going to show you an array, but with complex numbers. So if you want to send it back to JavaScript, you need to send the absolute value. I'm displaying the message, and the function ends. When your code ends, the variable MSG is passed back into JavaScript. Precisely, there's no return, there's no nothing like this. MSG is passed back. If this code is empty, what does it get back? The initial input. It's useless, but it gets back the initial input. You can do whatever processing you want here. You have complex numbers available, filtering functions available, a lot of things. So basically, the output is a JavaScript message. This works only on IoT servers. So only on IoT. It cannot run on boards because boards are, first of all, slow. Secondly, not all the boards support Octave. So if you can install Octave on your board, yeah, it will work. If not, you have to do it in IoT server. We're going to talk in detail about IoT servers tomorrow and what you can do from signal processing to web programming. Any questions here? This is the speed of this node is rather good. Do not abuse it. So if you can do some computation in JavaScript and it's really simple, do it in JavaScript. If computation is more complex or implies complex numbers or integral transformation, use this. But buffer the data first and send the buffer of data. Don't send one number at a time. Don't make number computation on this one. It should be fine as long as you can hold it to 10 times a second. It should be okay. Any questions? Okay, so that's all for today.